So, who here is learning something new? Maybe not like knowledge stuff, but like a new skill. Anybody trying to pick up something that you haven't done before? Michael was really encouraging to me in this because, as you know, the bone doctors have me doing exercises to try and strengthen my bones instead of taking the medicines to try and strengthen my bones. And so I've been going to the gym for, I don't know, 3 months now, almost 3 months now. And especially in the very, very beginning, I was very discouraged. I was very kind of just down. I wasn't getting as quick a results as I wanted to. I'm still not. Because I'm going to look different, right? And but Michael was just so very kind to me because I was in the middle of just kind of complaining about this and frustrated about this. And he says, "Dad, you're trying to change your whole life." And he was right. You know, I getting up at 5 o'clock in the morning is new for me. And all of the equipment is new for me. And I, you know, I didn't know quite what to do with some of it. And she taught me, and Philippe and Spencer, the nice physical therapist there at the gym, OSF's gym, taught me some stuff. But you know, what, is there anything that you're trying to learn right now? Something new that you picked up? Okay, everybody's doing the same old boring stuff. What are you trying to learn?
Archery?
Yeah. Awesome. Okay, so tell us just a little bit about, like, okay, why, first of all? Why archery?
Fun.
Seems fun. Okay, cool. So did you have to buy equipment?
Yeah, I bought a bow.
Okay. You didn't have it laying around the house, so you had to buy it. And then you just, what, you're just doing it on your own, or you got somebody showing you how? Just on your own. So you're knocking the arrow into the, it's called knocking, right? Into the string, and you're pulling back, and what's happening? Like the first time, you've got like hay bales set up, or what are you shooting at?
Water bottles.
Shooting water bottles, okay. Are you hitting water bottles?
Yeah.
Are you? Were you from the very beginning?
No.
No. So what were you doing from the very beginning? Okay, missing. Were you missing wide? Were you missing like, were you close? Or was it just really, really bad at the beginning?
It wasn't that bad.
It wasn't that bad? Cool. Because, you know, for me, when I'm trying to learn all these machines and stuff like that, it was really, really bad. Okay, so the only reason I'm bringing this up is because what we're going to do this morning is that, and what I was being encouraged by is that there's a progressive nature to learning. You don't just pick it up. You very rarely do you decide to do something new, think something new, and it just instantly takes off. There's speed bumps. There's problems along the way. There's discouragement. There's, you know, all these kinds of things. And because we're going to learn something today and in the future, because here's the thing. We are going to have to learn some new things in this culture. Everything is changing, and it's changing so fast that we are going to have to learn some things to move forward in this time frame. To stay true to God's word and to also be able to engage the people around us, we're going to have to learn some new things, especially anyone in the room that is under the age of about 30. You are going to have to learn some new things to navigate this world while staying true to your faith and yet still be able to have conversations with people. And that falls to us to teach them, by the way, doesn't it? If you're older than 30 in the room, doesn't that fall on us to teach our kids? Here's what we got to do here. Because, and there's a Christian rock band, Skillet, if anybody knows Skillet. And somebody's going, yeah, Skillet is a really, really good rock band. And their lead singer of all people voiced what I've been trying to figure out for a while now about the culture. And it is this. It is not enough any longer for us to kind of just say, okay, you do you. It's not enough in our culture for us to say, okay, that right there, I'm going to point out that that is sin. And, but, you know, you're free to go and you're free to do that because you have free will. And so kind of you do you, I'll do me, and we'll all just get along. That's not enough anymore. John Cooper, the lead singer of Skillet, said it, and I think he's right. What has changed is that now we not only have to accept what that other person is doing, we have to celebrate it, or we are considered to be unkind, unloving, hateful, et cetera, et cetera. So not only do we have to say it's okay, we actually have to encourage it. That's the change in the culture right now. So something in the church has to change too. We have to figure this out. And we're right back into Titus. And Paul writing to Titus has already given us a very clear expectation that we are to further the faith. We're to further the faith and to further the truth that leads to godliness. And last time, it was 2 weeks ago, we also looked at this incredible promise that the work of furthering the faith actually brings to life and brings to light something that God promised since before the beginning of time. So you can read all that. You can listen to the old message if you want to, but that is amazing to me. I mean, how amazing is that? That when we further the faith, when we further truth that leads to godliness, what is happening there in the other person that is getting it is, you know, it's being brought to light. It's being a kind of aha moment has been planned since before the beginning of time. And you're just tapping into the promise. That's incredible. So Paul is going to add something to your teaching today that is going to make it so much more effective. In chapter 2, you repeatedly hear the word teach. And that's a significant way that we further the faith. You know, Felipe and Deanna and Spencer taught me how to use the equipment. Manuel there is kind of on his own, but he's learning, right? He's you know, in time you may kind of, I don't know, find somebody that's done this before and learn from them. But we're all in the business of furthering the faith through teaching. And the reason I love the word teach and the ways that I love that it's been repeated throughout chapter 2 is that progressive nature. It's that I'm not going to get this right. It's that I'm going to read this. I'm going to look at this. I'm going to try for this. I'm going to fail at it. And I'm going to try again. It's that progressive nature of faith and teaching that I really like. So very, very practical section here, starting in chapter 2. You, however, must teach what is appropriate to sound doctrine. Teach the older men to be temperate, worthy of respect, self-controlled, and sound in faith, in love, and endurance. Likewise, teach the older women to be reverent. And that word means temple fitting. So it goes right back to modesty that we talked about from 1 Timothy. To be reverent or temple fitting in the way that they live, not to be slanderers or liars or gossips or addicted to much wine, but to teach what is good. Then they can urge the younger women to love their husbands and children, to be self-controlled and pure, to be busy at home, to be kind, and to be subject to their husbands so that no one will malign the word of God. I just want to pause real quickly and say, you'll see it all over in scripture, but I want us to see that everyday responsibilities, everyday life, be self-controlled, be pure, be busy at home. Everyday life, busy at home in our society, in our culture would be laundry, dishes, cleaning, food prep, you know, all the normal everyday stuff, playing with the kids, helping with homework. And everyday life is connected to spiritual life. You see that everywhere. The basics of the faith, the character of holiness and godliness, they go side by side. Verse 6, similarly, encourage the young men to be self-controlled. There's that word again. In everything, set them an example by doing what is good. In your teaching, show integrity, seriousness, and soundness of speech that cannot be condemned, so that those who oppose you may be ashamed because they have nothing bad to say about us. And then in verse 9, teach slaves to be subject to their masters in everything, to try to please them, not to talk back to them, and not to steal from them, but to show that they can be fully trusted, so that in every way they will make the teaching about God our Savior attractive. Now, there's some specifics there, but when you boil it all down, you're in verse 7 and 8. Teach character. Exhibit character. Model character. Verse 7 says, in everything, set them an example by doing what is good. In your teaching, show integrity, seriousness, and soundness of speech that cannot be condemned, so that no one else who opposes you may be ashamed, that those who oppose you may be ashamed because they have nothing bad to say about us. So you boil it all down, teach character, exhibit character, model character. You know, character like the things that are listed there. Character like don't be a slanderer. Character like being worthy of respect. Character like self-control that is mentioned, I don't know, 5 times. And maybe come back to that. So Titus 2 is a place that we often come and we talk about the Titus 2 women, because it very clearly says that the older women are to teach the younger women these things. Well, it's not like everyone else is left out, okay? So this is generation to generation. This is men to men, women to women. This is teaching. This is modeling. This is, the quote I ran across that I thought summed it up best is, living that pleases God provides a pattern for others to pursue. A lot of P's in there because somebody was trying to help you remember it. But living that pleases God provides a pattern for others to pursue. The way I thought of it is, be taught, then teach. Get it? Get it. Be taught, then teach. So God is teaching me about this characteristic. I must be putting that into somebody else at some point, some way, somehow. God is teaching me this. I must let that go towards someone else. The most important place that you can do that is in your home. Absolutely. And it's the place where it's already happening in our homes, right? I don't know. Let's just move, because this is what we've already seen. This is what you're already doing. You're already discipling. You're already teaching character lessons to your kids, to one another, to other people around you. You're already tapping into the promise of this, you know, life that's brought to light. That is promised. You're already learning how to guide these lessons back to Christ, which that thing about the almonds was awesome. I had never thought about that one. You know, I love looking in the Old Testament for pictures of Christ, and I've never thought about that one before. The other thing about it, just way aside, the other thing about it is every one of those other sticks was dead. Because you and I are dead in our sin and our trespasses, and we are helpless, and we can't do anything, and we have to accept that this one that gives us life, that is it. And so we can't just keep pursuing our own dead ways. We have to grab onto the fruit of Christ. Starting at verse 11, Paul adds something. And this is where I want to spend most of our time, because this just, I just love this. We find in these verses, I believe, what we desperately, desperately need in this culture and this time. So verse 11 says, "For." Now, that's not kata from last time. It's gar in Greek. And basically, it just means, here's the reason. Here's the ground of the command. God's commands are always rooted in his grace, right? You've heard me say, if you have trouble with obedience, look to God's side. That's what I mean by that. But for, in this case, actually means the power to obey. This is the source from which we teach. This is the source from which we further the faith. For, the grace of God has appeared that offers salvation to all people. It teaches us to say no to God, ungodliness and worldly passions, and to live self-controlled, here's that word again, upright and godly lives in this present age, while we wait for the blessed hope, the appearing of the glory of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us to redeem us from all wickedness and to purify for himself a people that are his very own, eager to do what is good. These, then, are the things that you should teach. Encourage and rebuke with all authority. Do not let anyone despise you. So go back. Paul says, Titus, teach. Teach the old men, teach the young men, teach the women, teach the old men to teach the young men, teach the young, you know, it's that generational, generation to generation, person to person, be taught, then teach. And then Paul reminds and emphasizes. Did you see it in verse 12? Grace teaches us. There's all this emphasis in the first part of the chapter of you, be an example, you teach, you absolutely pour yourself into someone else's life from time to time or in a focused way. Doesn't matter. It does matter. But, you know, in some way, the things that you're learning, the things that you are bringing into your life, you must move them into someone else's. And there's all this emphasis on you teach. And then Paul comes along right on the heels of that and says, oh, by the way, grace teaches us. And that was where I just went, oh, see, remember, rest in that truth that grace teaches us. I find every bit of those three words just absolutely marvelous. and like an actor, you know, a beginning actor running lines, I just kind of went through that. Grace teaches us. Flawed, sometimes helpless, sometimes seemingly hopeless, inconsistent, stubborn, difficult to teach us. Also, ransomed, loved, honored, treasured us. When you look at grace teaches us, and you're an adult in the room with kids, think of your kids. Oh my gosh, they're a pain sometimes. Oh my goodness, it is very difficult to teach them sometimes. Oh my goodness, you homeschoolers, God bless you. We didn't have one of that joke. But think of, you know, grace teaches us. So I want you to remember in that both the challenge and the difficulty and the stubbornness and the but also the passion and the love and the just, oh my goodness, I love you so much, my son. I love you so much, my daughter. You must learn this lesson. Please hear me. So grace teaches us. Grace teaches us. Progressively, slowly, over time. I had this thought about teaching, that teaching is consistency for our inconsistency. He is very inconsistent with the bow at the moment. But as he learns, he will become more and more consistent. And how does he become more and more consistent? By consistently practicing. Teaching is consistency. Over and over, lessons given over and over. No, Jim, you got to love that guy. I know he drives you crazy, but you got to love that guy. Jim, I'm sorry that this isn't going your way, but, you know, stop acting like a child. And those lessons just keep getting repeated and repeated and repeated. Consistent. It's consistency for our inconsistency. It's his word of perfection for our flaws and mistakes. Moms, dads, do you remember teaching your kids something really challenging? I remember more than once, and by more than once, I mean that I can remember from sitting in my dad's lap doing math. I still don't do math well. Sitting in my dad's lap doing math, sitting beside my dad doing math, and sitting at the kitchen kitchen table across from my dad learning math. I think that probably me learning math is the reason why my dad has the amount of hair that he has in his life right now. I'm making a joke, but I'm telling you, I have distinct memories of my father trying to teach me math and doing this. and looking at me like, why can't you get this? And yet he loves me. He wants me to do well. And so he's there, right? mean, parents, do you remember trying to teach your children something challenging like that? That's what we're talking about. But most importantly, grace teaches us. Think of the definitions that you know of grace. Think of definitions that you've heard in the past. Think of, you know, I just wrote down a bunch of them, kind of more phrases or just words that aren't full definitions. But, you know, understanding, power, preference, undeserved favor, giftedness, full payment, chosenness teaches us. Because that's what grace is. He chooses us. And this grace teaches us how to live. It transforms. It teaches us to do everything important, and it connects everything to Jesus. All the everyday relational things, it connects back to Christ. Verse 12 says, grace teaches us to say no to ungodliness and worldly passions. In other words, it teaches us to stay strong in this ever-bending culture. No, say no to ungodliness. But it also teaches us to live self-controlled, upright, and godly lives in the present time. So not only to stay strong, to keep the conviction against compromise, but also to live in a positive, healthy, attractive way. How does it do that? Verse 13 says, grace teaches us while we wait for the blessed hope, which is what? The appearing of the glory of Jesus, our great God and Savior. He gave himself for us, verse 14, to redeem us from, verse 14 says, to redeem us from all wickedness. So to redeem us, to say no to God, ungodliness and worldly passions, and a people eager to instead live self-controlled, upright, godly lives in this present time. Now, here's the thing. Why is that so important? Why is it so important that we bring grace into the conversation? Why is it so important? Why did I pause so long right there on grace teaches us? Grace teaches us. Grace teaches us. Do you know what grace teaching us brings into the conversation that we desperately need right now? Humility. Because I may know more than you, but I was taught it. I don't, but I may pray more than you. I may pray better than you. I may teach better than, or I may know more than you, but I was taught it. And grace taught me. Undeserved favor taught me. Chosenness taught me. I may be right, and you may be dead wrong. But if grace taught me, I no longer have any room for superiority. I can't from on high just, you know, you are wrong. I can't do that. Not if grace taught me. If grace taught me, that changes everything about the way a challenging conversation is going to go. If grace taught me, imagine if you are able to tap into the child you, the little bitty boy, the little bitty girl, imagine if you were able to tap into the child you trying to learn for the first time while you now teach your kids. Imagine if you could tap into the five-year-old boy who is looking at this and has no clue what to do with untied shoes because mom and dad have always tied them for him. I mean, I don't know who taught you to tie your shoes. Yeah, we used Velcro a lot when I was a boy. But, you know, somebody took the time to do, you know, like this, you cross it over, And then, you know, you put it like, and you tie it, and you really tight. Got it. That's pretty easy. Okay. And then you take this hand and you make a loop, and then you wrap around the loop, and then you put it through of the loop, and you pull it through. I did not get that. Right? Imagine if you could tap into child you. That's grace. Imagine, like I said, I can be absolutely right. I am absolutely right. You are absolutely right. If you are holding to the conviction of scripture that, you know, this is wrong behavior and this is right behavior, you are absolutely right. You stand on that with all conviction and all strength, but you stand on that with all conviction and strength and humility. Because grace taught you that. Grace taught me that such and such is wrong and such is right. And the only reason why I'm doing it right now is because I did it wrong a lot. Grace teaches us. Finally, verse 15 says, these then are the things you should teach. Teach this. Teach right. Teach wrong. Teach character. But remember that grace taught you first. So teach it with humility. You know my phrase, it's speaking Jesus. It's pushing every lesson back into Christ. These then are the things that you should teach. Jesus is what empowers us and enables us and ennobles us. It's a good word. And the very last part of verse 15. These then are the things you should teach. Encourage and rebuke with all authority. Do not let anyone despise you. The world is caught in doing one or the other. Encourage. You're okay. You'll find your way. Encourage. Or rebuke. You're wrong. You're canceled. You're evil. You're going to hell. You're completely without merit. You are, helpless, hopeless. You are never going to amount to anything. As long as you're in this lifestyle, you are, whatever. The world is caught doing either one. It is only in Christ, and it's only when we recognize grace teaches us that we get to do both. And that is what desperately is needed, right? We must encourage, we must rebuke. And they both go hand in hand only in Christ, only in grace. And I hope that makes sense. We're going to come back to it, I think, probably more than once, because this is the world we are in. That's why I love that phrase, wherever it was that, in the present age, that we are doing these things while living in this present age, while we wait for the blessed hope, to live self-controlled, upright, and godly lives in this present age, while we wait for the blessed hope. These are the things that are necessary. These are the things that we must learn. I had a story, but it's gone. And it's not there, so. All right, I'm done now. God, if it was important, bring it back to my mind and we can end with it. But I'm just going to start with thank you for teaching us. Thank you that grace teaches us. Thank you that all of us are still learning. Grace teaches us to say no to ungodliness, and yet every single person in the room says yes to ungodliness at times. Thank you that grace doesn't give up, grace doesn't stop, Grace doesn't turn its back. Grace doesn't retreat. Grace advances and says, no, no, here's how to do it. Here's how to say no to ungodliness. Thank you that grace teaches us self-control. Grace teaches us to live godly lives. Thank you that grace teaches us all things good, all things godly, all things character. And my one prayer, my one action for myself and the people in the room and the people online is that we would take the things that you have taught us and move them out toward other people, starting in our homes, but not leaving out our friends, our other family, other opportunities that you give. And I thank you that it's already happening. I thank you that we're already, like I said before, in many ways that we don't count, or we think don't count. We're already doing it. I'm just asking that we keep doing it. I'm asking for fruit from it. I pray for godly lives from godly lives. I pray for changed lives from changed lives. And I pray and ask that as we live out your truth, as we further the faith, as we speak godliness and speak truth that leads to godliness, I pray for salvations. I pray for new people who have no clue and don't know to know you. Let grace teach them. We pray that in Jesus' name. Amen.